So welcome to the Active Teaching Lab. My name is John Martin, and each week, every Friday morning, we invite an instructor to come and talk about how they've used some technology in their classroom. We ask them to talk about what I wanted, what I tried, what happened, and what I would do next time, sort of cover those four things. Then we have a hands-on activity, where with these activity sheets that you should all have at this point, I've printed off enough. You can follow through some easy things, some hard things, some medium things, different challenges to give you some good hands-on experience yourself. Once you have that hands-on experience, you can ask better questions when we unpack pedagogy and discuss some of the issues that we're facing. It's sponsored by Doing Academic Technology in the Teaching Academy. And today, for some reason, the projector's a little bit wonky, so you're missing the slides in all their glory. This is our fifth semester doing this, and over the last four and a half semesters, we've covered a lot of really cool tools. And they're all worth going back to and seeing. This spring is all focused on Canvas. Because the university is transitioning to Canvas, we decided let's look at all the tools in Canvas and all the things you can do in Canvas with other tools. So it's all focused on Canvas and teaching better with Canvas. And you can grab a schedule on the back table there if you want to cover the rest of them. We have these every other Monday as well. So if you can't make Friday mornings, which you all can now, witness. You can come Mondays at 12:30 to 1:30, same location. You should bring a buddy because we get judged by how many seats are filled. So come fill the seats. Good job today. Thank you for coming. And if you missed any of the labs or you want to go revisit some of those in the past four semesters, we captured them all on video. And they're on the Academic Technology site that you can get to at ap.doit.wispedia.edu. And there are links to it on the top of your activity sheet here as well. There's that bit.ly e-journal, ATL e-journal, you can see them all. And what we do with the video is we have the first 10-minute story where the instructor talks. So you can hear their story, and you don't have to watch the whole hour. But if you like what the instructor says, and you're like, oh, this is really interesting, I want to find out more of what they did, and the chaos that ensues during the hands-on activity, or the Q&A afterwards, discussion afterwards, you can go in and watch those 50-minute videos as well. But you don't have to. And if you have any ideas for labs, we're trying to put together next semester's sessions already. So if you do something cool in Canvas, industry, and you would like to share, you certainly can, and we encourage you to do that. I'm happy about that. All right, so this whole instructor story, what I wanted, what I tried to happen, what I do next time, we're going to get Sue Anker in here to talk about speed grading, but she already had come in on Monday and talked about that, so you can catch that on a video. And instead, we're going to talk about tips and tricks, sort of the things that we've been learning over the last two semesters of transition. We have about 16 months to go before everybody should have moved over to Canvas. And there's a lot that has already happened in the Canvas space this year. I'm going to take this off. Excuse me. Shitting out. All right. So, let's get started. As I said, this is going to be different from most things because we usually have an instructor come up and talk about what they wanted, what they tried, and what happened. But today is more of a learn by doing activity. I've got a bunch of smart people in the room who've already used Canvas, who've already started looking at stuff. And so this is really not going to be me presenting, but it's going to be a bigger conversation. So as you know, Canvas transitioning to Canvas over the next 18 months. 16 now. There are a lot of different contacts that you have, your local contacts that you can go talk to, and these people have been digging into Canvas quite a bit. There are a bunch of other people that are not listed on this contacts page that you can talk to as well. And if you look to your left and right, you might be able to recognize some of them. And then, of course, there are thousands of other people in the campus Canvas community. So if you have not yet gone to the campus, the Canvas community, through the help thing on your Canvas toolbar, this is a great place to go to get information. Because these are not just support people, these are instructors who are facing problems that a lot of support people often don't face. One of the problems is that unless I'm teaching, I don't know what issue you're having. And if I'm teaching a small class and you teach a big class, I haven't seen your issue firsthand. So I don't know how to solve these problems. A lot of people in the site have, and they will come and they will have these conversations back and forth about how to solve these problems. So a lot of the things that have come up over the past, questions or thoughts you'd like to see on Canvas on the back of your activities page, a lot of these are answered in this Canvas community. So I really encourage people to go there. It's a great resource. In addition to that, the 40, 80, 60 people on campus who are Canvas instructional technologists have been going through and having these conversations with Canvas people all the time. These are just mine talking about the Google Apps LTI authorization failures. I don't know if anyone else is running into this thing where you embed something in Google and then your students can't see it. That has something to do specifically, I think, with the UW integration of our single sign-on system with Google Apps does not work well with Canvas's Google LTI integration. So we're working with Canvas, and Dale, actually, our admin, has a date with the Canvas developer of the Google LTI coming up to talk about this. So we're tracking down a lot of these things. You're welcome. This is what we do. But it's also, you guys are doing this. So it's you guys, right? Because we set up today. Again, so much information in the room already. So today's going to be more of a discussion. So let's get going and start off. You all should have if you signed up, if you registered, and even if you didn't register, I think if you signed in, you're being added to the Active Teaching Lab, our Canvas course in Canvas, as instructors. So you can all go in and start to play around with some of these things and make a module and make a page and mess it around, and that's all right. Feel free to go ahead and mess things up a little bit. Create new stuff rather than deleting old stuff, because some of the old stuff we're going to reuse, so don't go too crazy and changing things around. But go in and play around if you don't already have your own Canvas course. And if you do have your own Canvas course, feel free to continue to do that. So, let's talk. We've got the what is it that you need going on here, and we've got some things already. So today's going to be really more of a discussion, and we're going to get some time of quiet time, heads down time, to go in and dig around on things. But let's start off with addressing a couple of things. First of all, as you look through the activity sheet, are there any things in here that you're like, oh, this is useful if you look through that? Raise your hand if you found something useful. All right, good. That means I haven't wasted my time making this. Excellent. What is useful? Let's talk about a problem. Are there any questions that you had that you either asked here or on the Google form that you may have gotten if you got the comments email about this that have been addressed?
Just a clarification on that extra credit, because I use it in one of my courses, and just make sure you mute the assignments, because if they get a zero, that means they take that bonus and they see that zero, and then it's emailed to them, and then they'll email you and say, I took that bonus and I got zero. So it's good to mute all of those bonus assignments, then give them whatever point they should have got, and then unmute them. Otherwise, you'll get upset students.
Excellent point. So this is, again, a great example of something that I didn't think of because I didn't have those emails come to me. But you probably thought of it because you got some emails, people asking, I got 0 points, but it's supposed to be extra credit.
Exactly.
Right.
I got 0 credit.
Good. Other experiences that people have had. Eileen.
I grade mine on a point system.
Mm-hmm.
And I started by grouping my assignments, grouping my tests, just like you would in D2L. And apparently, if you group them and you go to grade, it's automatically going to what percentage is this of the total grade? And I didn't want any percentages. I wanted a straight. So as I went exploring, it apparently you have to enter everything as an individual piece. You can't have a group of assignments or a group of tests. At least that's what I got from reading I did, in order to stay at points, and I couldn't revert back once I'd started.
This is, yes, and let me just put an exclamation point on that last part here. One of the things that I've noticed that is frustrating, and they do this for a good reason, once you start grading something, they don't let you change the rubric, they don't let you change the assignment, really, do they? Other than maybe some rewording?
I don't know about that.
But the points you can't change
you can't
and
change.
Any of that. I think with assignments they say you can't do this unless you have to, we'll reset everything, then you have to regrade everything, right?
That might have been what it was.
All right, so it's kind of, and that makes sense. You don't want to like grade half of the people and then change the criteria and then grade the other half because equity and all that stuff.
So what I ended up doing was exporting everything to Excel, doing it in Excel and grading it that way, and then going in and adjusting it so when they looked at it, they would have the grade I wanted them to have, not the grade that it was defaulting to.
All right.
That was just a frustrating extra step, but now I know that how to start off.
Good. Good. I should also say that because we're recording this, I think we're also going to go through and we'll collate all of these tips as we're talking. And so I'm not going to capture things perfectly here, but we're going to capture things better when we go through the video. Other questions people are facing? Things that you found? Yeah, Louis.
I have an instructor who is unhappy with the contrast pieces, you know, that it's actually a light gray font instead of a dark black. And so I helped her find an extension to put on Chrome, a high contrast extension, now she can read better. So it might be something that others who have trouble reading the way it defaulted.
And doesn't Chrome have a high contrast setting in their settings? I feel like I've run across that.
There is an easy extension though, so we like that.
Maybe not.
I think it's under your account. So if you go to account settings. At the very bottom it says high contrast UI.
Oh, yeah.
You can click that on. That's nice. I like that.
Does that change it for the entire course, or is it just for you and the user?
That's at the account level, so it would just be whoever needs it can change that for all of their courses
okay. That
are in Canvas. So it's not something that an instructor does for their class, but it's something the students or the instructor can do for themselves. So that color enhances the color contrast of the UI, making those items more distinct and easier to identify. Institution branding will be disabled. Oh, that's interesting. There goes VW Crest. I don't know if that's legal. All right.
It also takes away the red, because like all the red kind of bothers me. So
okay.
It makes everything gray and
white.
All
right, so I'm just going to save this, I guess, and see what it looks like. Then. How's that?
See? Look at that. So nice.
That's different.
Yeah.
Just unbranded the universe.
Yeah, hardly looks like an UW course anymore, doesn't it?
Do the discussions change then? Because I know it's where a lot of people, that's what's gray.
This still is gray. It looks not so light gray. Yeah, what is the name of the Chrome extension?
It's actually high contrast.
We'll let them remember that.
Put it in the discussion.
Ooh, excellent. All right, there's the UW stuff again. Very good. All right, so the excellent. We're coming up with some good ones. You could also add stuff, if you want, directly onto the activity sheet. I give everybody editing rights today, so at the very bottom, you can share your ideas and suggestions down here. Yes, Dan.
I'll come up with one, something I like about it. That was unexpected. A lot of our teachers teach multiple sections of the same course in parallel.
Okay.
And one thing that they found that they liked was that they could import all their students into a single Canvas page, divide them out into sections, or groups, I think it's called, and that way they only have to upload one version of everything. Everybody sees it, but the groups are kept separate, the grading is done separately, they're able to treat it like, you know, they're able to treat it both like separate courses and like one big class when it comes to actually uploading materials to it. And that saved, the people who are doing that say it saves them a lot of time. So even though they're separate courses within UW, they're being, Canvas is got them all imported into a single course.
Ah. So that, if they're separate courses in UW, that means that they have to be entered manually.
Yeah. They go through and they enter the names, but that's just a matter of downloading the mailing list and then typing that in and then adding them as students in one big group and then adding to that group.
All right.
You do that once at the beginning of the semester, and then they have another Canvas course for that class that is just unpublished. So all the students from like three sections will be in one Canvas course, and there's two unpublished ones that they don't use. Saves them a lot of time.
All right, very good. Yeah, groups is something that I have not played with very much. Has anyone played with groups? A little bit? James?
I taught last summer using groups, specifically built around a group tool on Canvas, and it was really nice because it does create separate spaces, basically separate group home pages for each of the groups.
Okay.
And so then I also like it because it gives more tools to the students to be able to do stuff as a group than you would get in like D2L or Moodle.
All right. Like what are those tools that it gives them?
So they get their own announcement board, they get their own collaboration space, they get their own discussion space, et cetera, et cetera. And it's all nicely grouped on one page.
Okay.
So it's navigation's easy. And
so it looks different than the regular home page then?
Yes. And so it is interesting because when you click into the group homepage, it's almost like you're leaving the course in that there's not an easy breadcrumb to get back to the main page, which has pros and cons. But for my purposes, it was nice because students knew this is my group homepage. We can do what we want here. We don't have to worry about anybody but us and the instructor seeing what's going on.
So as an instructor, were you able to see what they saw? Did the student view work in groups? Or did you have to like look over the shoulder to see what it was that they looked at?
Well, I mean, as an instructor, you're automatically enrolled in every group, so you can participate just as if you were a student in any of the groups.
All right. But you don't get the same view because you're looking at everything.
Well, no, because the group home pages, there's no, like, you can't edit the navigation bar for the group home page.
Would you be willing to open that up and then bring it up here and show us in a bit?
I sure.
We'll go on to other things, but come back and revisit that if you would be willing to share. That'd be awesome. Because I'd love to see that. Anyone else? Other ideas, thoughts? Challenges? Yeah, please, Daniel.
So positive thing, giving feedback to Canvas, they have that board where you post things when you identify a problem. And the positive side of that is I have had a lot of emails back from other instructors in other universities nationwide about certain problems that have come up that I have taken to Canvas to say, look, you need to fix this. So that Canvas community is really nice in that you get other people kind of writing back in solidarity. The downside of that is that the emails are mostly along the lines of, I can't believe they haven't done anything about this. They've known about this problem for a year and it affects every one of my students. It's, why do we even need to vote for something that has, you know, that is clearly a flaw in
the software? Can I bring one of yours up?
So, yeah. There's only really one of mine up there right now, but
that was
my experience. I've avoided
making feedback more visible to students?
Yes, there's a real glitch in that. And it's got over 200 votes, and it's on their radar, they say, but it's been on the radar for a long time.
199.
It's going down. Somebody voted it down. Because it was 206 the last time.
Yeah, it was John.
There you go.
All right, so if you guys all get into this Canvas site, and by the way, you should add a picture, because otherwise you look like an anonymous person.
I haven't got a picture up there.
Here's a good Canvas.
Yeah, that, I'm not going to write to their feedback board about that.
There's your...
That's a nice picture.
Oh, thank you. That's my standard...
Same shirt.
In front of the webcam picture. Photos. Well, this is good. So, yeah, you uploaded some photos here, right? But did you upload an avatar?
Oh, God.
I know. It's a little confusing.
How many?
So, yeah, you can be all these anonymous pandas, or you can add some of your own avatars. And then you got to go down to the add avatar here in order to... Otherwise, you're going to be a gray anonymous thing. Unless people click on you, then they can see your photo, but...
They're all angry looking on that page.
Pandas, and they're from Canvas. Come on.
That's why you write for Canvas.
You'd be happy?
Let me talk. If anyone has any question about anything, so one of the questions was, let's do this. How to add students to a sandbox course.
Oh, we can do that easy.
I can do that even without this.
So the Active Teaching Lab is actually a sandbox course, and all I need to do, Chad, is to go to people here. And click on plus people. And they just changed this last week, 2 weeks ago. So now I can identify them by their email address, their login ID, or their SSID, which means SISID, which means something to administrators, but not to me.
Student Information System.
Yeah, Student Information System.
Formerly known as ISIS.
Yeah.
So if I wanted to add somebody, let's just say that somebody is John Martin.
And I knew his login ID, I think. I could just do this. Yep. Back. I guess I have to do his email.
You have
to click login ID. No. Mm-hmm. All right, so login ID doesn't really work for me. But this will. And this will also work if you take a big list from like an Excel sheet. You don't have to put commas in between them. You can just sort of copy it and paste it in there. And generally, it'll work as long as there's not extra stuff in between the names. And I hit next.
Is that because this is your class? That you already exist in it?
Between the John and the Martin. John
dot Martin.
But it should, I both work. So to John Martin or John dot Martin, I will get something. All right, if this doesn't work, I'm going to be sad. All right, there we go. So it's all ready. We add it. And then you just click on add users.
Yeah, so this morning I was able to download an Excel file with everyone that registered and just copy the column and paste it, and it automatically, so I didn't have to copy each separately or anything.
So that one's easy. Yeah. How that students.
So how do you designate a sandbox course?
How do you designate a sandbox course? Oh, so good. You go to the Cambridge Info site.
Oh, that's right.
And if you don't already have a sandbox course, you should get one because they're free. Canvas course. And all you have to do there is fill out a Qualtrics form, your name, your email address, choose your school, college, institute, or division here. It's going to make me do this so I can't go on to the next one. Anyway, on the next page it talks about what course are you going to use this for, and you know, they just kind of get some information. So it's kind of a, it's an easy process, and it takes like a day, and then you'll get an email saying, you've got one. So even if this is not the official course that you're teaching, and you just want to learn how to do this, or if you know somebody's like, oh, I've always wanted to learn how to use an LMS, like your graduate students can go in, create a course that they can then take to the next school that they want to teach at, right? So if you have students that want to get some teaching experience, you say, hey, here, redesign a course and make it in Canvas and then take it with you and go teach it whatever your class. That way you can go to the interview and say, I've got this course, I'm all ready to teach.
Look, here's what Canvas can say. All right, so that was easy, mostly. Let's ask another question. Setting up grading, so mo percentage.
That was me.
Oh, some percentage. Right.
You already answered that.
Excellent. What handout of what mobile does and doesn't do? Ooh, has anyone used the mobile devices? Which ones?
iPad.
Do you use the Canvas
iPad
basic
apps.
Course? Good.
And SpeedGrader.
Canvas basic course?
Canvas Behind.
SpeedGrader? Have you used the SpeedGrader app?
Yes.
So you've got two Canvas apps on your phone?
I have four.
You have four.
There's the Canvas Parent. I tried downloaded it just to see what it would do. And there's something else. I can't remember what it was.
The fourth one is Polls, Canvas Polls.
Yeah.
Have you tried that?
Not useful.
I have not tried that either. It's only got three stars, so. Until it gets four stars, I'm not going to try it. have you tried Canvas Polls?
No. They're glitchy. In my even on basic functions on the apps, things that ought to work. Sometimes down.
That's what the three stars said, or the one stars in the three star rating said. Yeah.
They feel very much like a work in progress.
They say it has promise,
yeah.
But or potential, but not there yet.
They're very handy for going off for students to go on and check stuff. I think that the student experience is probably pretty good on the apps compared to the teacher experience. You cannot edit easily with the apps, but when you go in just to look up information, they're great. So for a student to check their homework, for a student to check something you posted, you know, that works well.
And that's what you want when you're on the bus thinking, what do I have to do to prepare for today's class?
But you don't want to be trying to edit your Canvas course even a little tiny bit, or even emailing your students through the Canvas app, because that doesn't even work.
But you've used the SpeedGrader on Canvas, on the Canvas app.
Sort of.
Sort of a little bit.
Yeah.
Miguel loves it. Miguel Garcia Gonsalves at the School of Business. So he just takes his iPad and uses the rubric stuff, you know, yes, and next.
Yeah, if you've already set up a rubric, it works really well. If you're trying to grade something that's got a lot of text, I mean, just simply the size of the screen restricts so much what you can see that it becomes, you know, kind of.
All right, so good for rubric, for reading things that are rubric-driven assignments.
Something simple that you can grade pretty much with one finger, yes.
Not so good for the Crocodoc style.
No way,
give it
wouldn't
feedback.
Want to.
Okay,
go near,
no way.
Go near.
All right, that's good to know. Sarah?
I asked the question because I was wondering from the student perspective, and I was watching a video yesterday that was a little outdated, so I'm not sure if this is still true, but it said some types of quiz questions don't work on mobile devices. So I was wondering if there's a list anywhere of what are the features that do work for students on phones and what are the ones that don't, because you wouldn't want to set them up in a,
right,
with expectations that they could do their homework on their phone and then not be able to do it.
Right. I have not run across that, but that's a good, let me clarify. Some quiz questions don't work.
Formula questions or multiple fill-ins.
Oh, probably.
There are a few types listed.
That's good, good to know. And we have the same issue with Top Hat on campus, right? If you have the computer, you can do stuff. If you've got a smartphone, you can do all kinds of stuff. But if you have the old Nokia candy bar phone, then sorry. All right. How to create random quizzes. Who knows the answer to that? And who, what does that actually mean?
Well, it's my question.
All right.
So, in D2L, I have a large question bank.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for different topics, I've got maybe, say, 100 possible questions.
Uh-huh.
And I want students to get presented with 10 randomly selected questions so that they can practice, or so they can take a pre-lecture quiz. And so, as I look at what's been imported into my new Canvas course, instead of having a quiz with 10 questions, I've got a quiz with 260 questions.
Yep. Ooh. But you only want 10 of those questions in their quizzes.
Yep.
All right, there are 7 people in the room who have done this. Who would like to bring theirs up and show it? I know that there are 7 people. There's got to be 7 people who have done this. Has anybody done this? Work from a question bank?
I made a quiz that has randomized questions in it.
Is it the same 7 questions, for example, that are just in different order?
No. There's a group of 10 questions and they get 3.
All right, so question bank of 10. Yes, that's what I want.
Okay.
Yay, Eva. Hey, Megan. All right. So we'll get that answered, and then James, you can come up and show yours in a minute too. Any other questions?
What's the best way to avoid that insecure content message when you're linking out to things in a module? Is it best just not to, I mean, for consistency, I've been tinkering with adding different readings and things, but, and sometimes you get that message and sometimes you don't. Is that just a matter of?
So my understanding of this, and folks in the back row could probably answer this, that is a whitelist question, right? If something is whitelisted at the admin level, then it'll go through and it won't get that question. So for example, Google Docs, Google Apps, no longer gets that message, and it used to. And then you'd see this thing and the students or whoever would have to click this extra button, and then they would see the content.
Right.
I believe that we have convinced the administration that this is okay. If they get that, we don't need the students to have to click an extra button. Every extra button that the students click is an extra barrier to learning, and they may be very small little barriers, but you know, it's like, do you want to walk in the nice paved path to content, or do you want to have to like make your students really work to get the content? And in which case, are they learning how to navigate the terrain or of D2L or of Canvas, or is your learning goal to have them actually learn the content of your course? So that's a good question. I believe it's a whitelist thing. If you have something that you use a lot, like you always send them to BuzzFeed or whatever, you can send an email to the Learning Dummy support and ask them to turn that on and tell them, every week in class, I send them to this site.
Okay.
And I need this site for this thing. And I've used it for the last 3 semesters or whatever. And generally, they will turn that on.
Okay. I just wanted, because like one of them, I just was checking what we have here. And like, you send them. I'm in art history, so a lot of articles from Grover, Dictionary of Art.
Yeah.
And that's a university protected.
Yes. And it's just not one that they immediately thought of when they introduced Canvas. They're like, let's turn some things on.
Okay.
And, but they're computer admins. They would not think of the Grover thing for art. Yeah.
Thanks.
Ready, James?
I'm ready.
All right, whatever you want.
So this was a all online history course that I taught last summer, and because it was all online, and because discussion is like a huge part of history courses, we really relied on the group function as a way to kind of build some scaffolding around the students to help them through something, whether or not it's meeting me or their classmates every day. So it's actually a really simple thing to do. You can go to the People tab and you click on Groups. There's things called Group Sets, and you can actually have multiple group sets. So you can create groups for different purposes in the course. If you want one for discussion, but you want different groups for peer review or something like that, you can create different groups. So you just do Group Set, decide how many groups you want to do, and then it's also nice because you can like literally drag and drop people between groups.
So did you let them name themselves?
Yes.
That's amazing.
That was actually our opening activity. Not all of the groups took advantage, but the Spice Squirrels actually caught on really quick. In about 12 hours of class starting, they had identified themselves. So where it gets interesting is when to actually visit the group. You have to come in here, hit group, and then do visit group homepage. And as you see, it actually takes you out of the course, more or less, to a specific page that's dedicated just to this group with its own mini navigation bar. And so what I did is, any group-related announcements, I used Blackboard Collaborate Ultra, and I made each group their own space, basically, that they could access whenever they want, so I just dropped the link in their group homepage, so if they ever needed to get together, they had space available.
We have instructions on the back page about using Blackboard Ultra. Anybody use Blackboard Ultra here? All right, what do you think? I know Julie's very excited to demo it if you want.
There's a chat room open on Active Teaching Lab if you guys want to join.
the one thing I will say about Ultra is our contract runs out in June this year, but we will get something. We may still have Ultra. That's being decided at the system level. But there will be something, even if it's not old. Huh?
Are they looking at Zoom? We don't.
They rolled it into the RFP for the whole digital ecosystem guide, so I have no idea what's going on in that space.
Tangent, sorry.
So then you can also see there's an individual group discussion space where just that group can see what's in there. There's also a file space just for this group, and then a collaboration space where they can start collaborations with just this group. So it's just a nice way to like literally give them their own space that you can choose to be as involved or not involved in as much as you want.
So they can make pages to their heart's desire in these groups and pages and give each other announcements and drop files to share with each other. So it's their own virtual workspace.
Yeah.
That's kind of neat.
Yeah. And so then, and that's also why I also gave them the Ultra room so that they could have a place to actually meet and talk without waiting for typing or whatever. So.
Excellent. All right. Megan, you ready?
Sure. I have a little to no battery life.
There is a power. It might fit yours.
No, because the global navigation bar is over here, so if worse comes to worse, you just click on courses. I mean, they made initially the first time they made it. How do I get back? But they're never going to get lost.
No, this HTML is not necessary for work. But you have a GPT as well.
Yeah.
Oh, you do?
Okay.
I have everything that's been transferred from D2L into my Canvas.
Okay, and so you have question banks already? Okay, so this is a quiz that I made before. Actually, I'm going to make one because I teach anatomy. I don't know what you guys want to see this morning. So if you were in quizzes, so basically what you got to do is you have to go into, so we'll just make our quiz here, go into questions there, and you see these boxes here, and they're going to stay down at the bottom of the page, so the more questions you put in, you're going to have to go search for them. But if you want to do a randomized questions, what you do is you make a group, and then it's, you know, you're going to have group one, and then you just pick the questions per. When you create the group, say that you're going to have, and we don't have anything in it yet, when you create it, it's going to give you this warning, but once you start actually adding questions to it, the warning will go away. So I can just add a question normally, so I would just write one here, do that, correct answer. So if you want to write them, if you're bringing them in from another question bank, then you would do, this find questions takes you to all your different question banks. So you would just say, we'll take this question, you can scroll all the way down to the end of your list, and you'll find the question group. So it will just then add that into the group.
Okay. So that doesn't do as a random though, right? That's a manual version of from a question bank?
No way, she's...
No, it's gonna select, she's gonna select.
So now I have two questions in here, and it's going to pick one question.
Got it.
Yeah, so, and what you can do then, if you have multiple groups, because in some of ours we have multiple groups, so there's, you know, 30 questions divided into those three groups, you can move them pretty easily amongst the groups, or if you want, say we want this question to be on everybody's, and we can move it outside of the group. And so now this one on the bottom here is going to appear on everybody's exam. And they'll also get the one, you know, one question from the random group too. Once you get things in from the question banks, it's pretty easy to organize and just create the group.
Awesome.
So is there in D2L, you would have questions in a quiz, but then there's also like a question bank. Is there something, is it something similar like that in Canvas?
Yeah, and so I found that if you want to make everything, if you're making new questions, make them in a question bank, because if you make a new question in a quiz, it's not necessarily gonna show up in the question bank, which is where I had many problems. Which is what we'd like to learn how to do.
The thing with the question bank is, and unlike D2L, when you change the question in the question bank in D2L, it would change the versions in your quizzes. Canvas does not do that. Really annoying. So, but if anybody has a workaround, it actually gives you a warning on the question bank when you're editing. This will not change the question in the quizzes that you've made. I know.
Yeah.
So if anybody has a workaround for that, I'd love to hear it.
And so obviously also, if you change a question in a quiz, it doesn't change it back in.
Precisely. Exactly. And you've lost that question in the quiz that you built is stuck there. I haven't found a way that's really easy to get it into a question bank. It doesn't like just show up, you know, in a loose random folder. It's not in the question bank at all. So you have to actually export the whole quiz and then re-import the quiz into the question bank. If you want any of those questions that you wrote individually.
Which is a bit of a pain, but it's not hard to do the export and import of pieces. But it is a workaround you shouldn't have to. James.
Just one thing to keep in mind with everything quizzing in Canvas is that Canvas is actually releasing a whole new quizzing tool in the near future, so we have no idea what is going to change about this or not. We're hoping it's an improvement.
Yeah.
And this deserves another point. So whereas D2L, every 2 years or at the end of every year or something like that, we would get a new version that was generally 2 or 3 versions old. So D2L had the latest, greatest version, but UW-Madison would not ever take the latest, greatest version because the first latest, greatest version is usually wonky. So we'd go with the trusted 2 or 3 year old version, or older version, right? Canvas, every 2 weeks, updates their stuff. And on the Canvas course, the Canvas community, they have the, what is it called? Updates or something. Latest release. Oh, finished. So they've got these Canvas beta release, and then they've got regular release notes as well. And they'll actually have a video every 2 weeks of here are the new features that were in the last release that you should be getting this next week. And it's kind of a neat little 10-minute video that covers all of the latest things. So if we really want to stay up to date with what's going on with Canvas, and don't we all want to do that in our lives, that's the place to do it. They have a lot of weekly videos as well on, maybe I can just do a search for videos. So if you want to see videos on things, that's not a good one. That's all admins. They've got these videos that go over just about everything. So if you're a video learner, that's a good way to do that. And the release notes are kind of fun. I was just watching the one on the new Office 365 integration, and it was ridiculous because it's such a terrible integration. But it'll get better. Right? Okay, other thoughts? Send them grading out of pre-rooms. Okay, we did that one. And over here, how do you copy questions in a quiz? Hey, we just did that too, didn't we?
No, we didn't. How do you copy questions in a quiz?
Like, no, we didn't.
It's my question. It's for my question. If I want to make a question, I have a question with a picture in it, and I ask about one label in the picture in one question and another label in the picture in the other question, in D2L, which I miss only for the quizzing, I could copy that question and then alter it. Duplicate
the question, maybe, is a better way of saying it. Can I do that? Does anybody know? I can't figure out how to do that. No, I'm kidding. Take a quick look. I think I have a quiz here.
Question bank.
Right.
Yeah, important. That's the workaround that I mean, it works. But. It's not perfect. Okay, I'm waiting for that update then.
And really, I feel like the Canvas community has more workarounds than answers. But, you know, maybe Canvas will get the hint and say, huh. On the other hand, maybe they'll be like, well, it's not an issue because there's a workaround.
Yeah.
Have you guys all seen the H5P content? I like this a lot. Oh, also, this is an example of the different ways to embed Google in your pages. You can see that here's the one where I just embedded using the iframe from Google Docs published to the web. And it's crappy. It reformats things, like things that don't look good at all. If you change the URL in the iframe and that last slash you add preview, it gives you this very nice, clean look with the margins, and nobody can edit stuff, but it looks very nice. If you want them to have the editing tools, so you set your permissions so that the students can comment or edit the paper, so like a sign-up sheet or something like that, then you just change the end of the URL to have slash edit in your iframe, and those are all listed on the bottom of this page, I think, or the back, top of the back page here. And then the current issue that I'm having that I showed you, those 55 emails, is using the Canvas Google LTI tool, so using that little V. You need to authorize the login to use this integration. This is what happens with me. I click authorize, and it's like, okay, cool, this is easy. We've all had to do this, right, for something. So I hit allow, and it says it's successful, but then it says, oh, authorization failed. Now, the reason this is happening is because up here in the corner, I'm logged in with my personal email account. However, elsewhere in my browser, I'm logged in with my Lisk account. Now, every other Google thing that I've had to do, it's this tab level login that lets you change stuff here. But Canvas, for some reason, doesn't go to tab level one. They go to this browser level login. And I never think about my browser level login. So I anticipate that most people don't even know that they're logged in with their browser. If they have an Android device, they are automatically logged in with their browser at the browser level thing. So unless they're logged in with wisp.edu with their phone, which, face it, most of our students don't want to do that. They want to use their personal Gmail for that. They're going to have this issue. And so I've been working with Canvas on that. So in the meantime, I just say use the iframe with the preview. That's my favorite way of doing things. Daniel.
John, just on that point, it's one of several things that on a Mac anyway work better in Safari than in Chrome. There are several issues that I've come up with during grading where it will hang on Chrome, but it won't in Safari. And First thing to try if it's misbehaving is try a different browser. In particular, Chrome has more issues that I've come across than
any. And this is actually a good point. This, if I'm logged in incognito mode, I don't have a problem. Okay. If I'm in Safari, it's not a problem. If I'm in Firefox, it's not a problem. It's only if I'm in Chrome with this other issue. But I like Chrome. That's, you know, so yeah, my problem.
Needs must.
Oh, quick H5P. Mm-hmm. So you guys seen this?
Yeah, that's a good one.
Let me make this a little smaller. Oh, it's not big enough.
There it is. Some authorizing, and I wouldn't
authorize. All right, so roses are, what is it? Red, okay. Yeah, good. Violets are? Blue. The active teaching lab is? Awesome. Oh, thanks, guys. Wait, there's a little note here, a hint. Oh, it's like you guys. Oh. And so are you. Woohoo! So H5P is really fun to start playing around with, and it's free, but h5p.org, there's how to do that on the middle of the back page here. It works in WordPress, it works in pretty much anywhere that you can embed iframes. This is one of, they've got like 40 different versions of this, so you can like, there are hotspots of if you have an image where you want to identify where is the whatever part of the pelvis versus where is the other part of the pelvis, you can do that in it and have them click the right spot and things like that. These do not connect to the gradebook in any way, so they're good for knowledge self-checks, but not anything else. All right, any last questions in the last minute that we have here today? Sarah?
On the activity sheet, I put a link to a blog post I made about how to add extra time to quizzes. So if anyone is wondering how to do that, the link is at the bottom.
All right.
The quiz tool. It only appears after you hit publish on a quiz. So if you've been planning out your course for the summer but you haven't hit the publish button, you wouldn't have noticed that there does exist a place where you can add extra time for students.
Yes. Hitting the publish button is a good thing to help you troubleshoot lots of issues that you might have that you might not think about. And if you hit that publish button, it'll help. Yes, Daniel.
I'm sorry. I have one more comment. Just a general tip is that from our experience, we've got about 25 instructors using Canvas now, and all their questions come to me. The student side of Canvas is not as solid as the teacher side and doesn't always function and appear in the same way that the teacher side does. And so it's something to do regularly is to go into that test view and see what it looks like as a student, even to the point of taking the quizzes or uploading your work, uploading a sample work and grading yourself and then going and looking at how it looks for the student, or looking over a student's shoulder in class or something, asking, can I just see how the page is looking? Because it's not always a perfect match between what you see and what they're going to see.
And let me go a step further and say, find a colleague that you like and trust and add them as a student and then sit down and have coffee with them and take each other's courses next to each other and say, what does that look like for you? Because even the student test view does not look like the student view sometimes.
Yeah, and the only negative to that is you have to open up that module in order to see the student view.
Which means you have to publish it.
If you're working on a module you don't want them to see yet and you want to test it, you have to quickly open it and hope nobody peeks while you're working on it. So that's
or put it in your sandbox that you keep
sandbox.
To test and play around in spaces as well. Mm-hmm. All right, we're out of time.